Due Process, winner of 12 New York and Mid-Atlantic Emmys, including the 2008 Award for Best Discussion Series.
When Sonia Sotomayor ascends those marble steps to assume her seat on the highest court of the land, America will have taken another important step towards realizing the ideal that is etched above its entrance. Equal justice under the law.
And on the first Monday in October, she will climb those steps. Another woman on the court, the first Hispanic. How she got there and the kind of justice she'll be. Up next on Due Process.
Major funding for Due Process provided by the New Jersey State Bar Foundation, committed to educating the public about the law, and by the Fund for New Jersey, supporting informed citizens for an effective democracy.
And then there were two. With the confirmation of Sonia Sotomayor, a second woman on the U.S. Supreme Court, and the first Hispanic. The first justice for whom English was not the first language, and Barack Obama's first pick for the country's highest court. I'm Sandra King, Raymond Brown is off, and on this edition of Due Process, the court's newest justice. How she got there, why she was opposed, what kind of justice she'll be. We'll talk to a Sotomayor friend and supporter, to a vocal detractor, and to an academic expert on the Constitution and the court. But first, a look back at the judge who is now justice, and the opposition she managed to overcome.
Whitehouse.
Unless you have a complete meltdown, you're going to get confirmed.
A strong Democratic majority meant confirmation was probably never in doubt. But there were questions the opposition had been sure to raise, both on the committee.
Empathy for one party is always prejudice against another.
And off.
I am concerned when someone comes to the court and says specifically, I will make decisions based upon, or at least influenced by, my sex or my ethnicity.
The Sotomayor quote that raised such a ruckus was from a 2001 speech, when she said that a wise Latino would, quote, more often than not reach a better conclusion than a white male who hadn't lived that life.
We have a woman who says being Latina and being a woman has an influence on how I see the world.
My personal and professional experiences help me to listen and understand, with the law always commanding the result in every case.
She's not saying she's going to treat people differently. She just believes that those experiences are going to help her make better decisions.
But one of this Latina's decisions was another source of contention. The judge was part of a Second Circuit panel that ruled against some white New Haven firemen who said they were the victims of racial bias.
Despite the important civil rights and constitutional claims we raised, the Court of Appeals panel disposed of our case in an unsigned, unpublished summary order. Such action deprived all of us the process set forth by the rule of law. Firefighters who earned promotions were denied them.
If the plaintiffs in that case had been Hispanic or black or women or any of the officially approved minority groups, there's no doubt in my mind the decision would have been different.
And in a 5-4 decision, the court she'll be joining reversed her ruling, saying New Haven didn't have the right to throw out the results of a promotional exam because blacks had scored poorly.
In the first place, nothing makes me as angry as to say that Judge Sotomayor is racist.
It was bad because it left an impression that I believed that life experiences commanded a result in a case, but that's clearly not what I do as a judge, It's clearly not what I intended.
And then there was the charge of judicial activism.
And I fear that this empathy standard is another step down the road to a liberal, activist, results-oriented, relativistic world where laws lose their fixed meaning, unelected judges set policy.
The criticism of that one is just to me, unbelievable, because Judge Scalia makes just as much law as any other judge in the history of this country, but because certain people agree with Justice Scalia, it's okay. He's not really making law. He's properly interpreting the law. When he makes it, it's okay. When someone else does it, it's not okay.
But the Women's Media Center says the criticism of Sotomayor went further than that.
She's an angry woman. She's a bigot. She's a racist.
She is reportedly domineering in oral arguments.
She was acting like sort of the school marm.
She is also an affirmative action pick.
She's the one who said out loud, I would probably make better decisions than a white guy.
She is a Marxist.
This video was designed to document the race and gender bias that the Women's Media Center says marked the confirmation process.
Of a Latino woman!
From the time the president first announced the nomination back in May.
I have decided to nominate an inspiring woman who I believe will make a great justice, Judge Sonia Sotomayor of the great state of New York.
The judiciary hearings took 4 days, the vote just minutes, with all Republicans but one, Lindsey Graham, voting nay. In the full Senate vote, it was 68 to 31, no Democrat voting against her, only 9 Republicans voting for her. And when we come back, a look at the journey of one wise Latina judge, the future of that new justice and the court she will join, so stay with us.
She's from the project, from the Bronx. Shows no matter where you're from, cream rises to the top. You can overcome anything.
As far as a woman and a Hispanic, I have absolutely no problem with that. I think it's great.
I think if she's qualified to do the job, then I'm all for it. And from what I can tell, she seems to be pretty qualified.
First black president, and now we got first Hispanic Supreme Court justice.
It's important that we have someone up there that represents us.
She has to do what's right. And to everybody, not just Hispanics.
I don't care if she's black, white, purple. As long as she can get the job done, that's all that matters to me.
And here to weigh in on the court's newest member and its new look, Seton Hall Law Professor Solangel Maldonado, an active member of both the Dominican and Hispanic Bar and a friend of the new Associate Justice. Curt Levey, Executive Director of the Washington-based Committee for Justice and a member of the Federalist Society's Civil Rights Practice Group. And with us from our Studio B, Princeton Professor Keith Whittington, an expert on politics, the court, and the Constitution. Welcome all of you to Due Process.
Thank you.
Solangel, let me start by asking you, why all the passion for an appointee whose experience on the court was not likely to change the direction of that court, not likely to be too much difference in the way Justice Souter would have voted and the way that Justice Sotomayor would, was pretty much she was going to have to crash and burn, as Lindsey Graham pointed out, to not be confirmed, and yet there was so much passion on both sides. Why?
Well, I guess to introduce, I guess, the elephant in the room, one of the reasons there was so much passion is because of some of her speeches, which I believe were misinterpreted, but which the media and obviously some senators believe indicated that she was going to be a particular type of judge, a judicial activist. That notion is actually not supported at all by any of her opinions, but I do believe that the senators and the media sort of took that and ran with it, the idea that she's going to be an activist.
Without the speeches, Curt, would there have been all of the excitement around this, or would it have been a sort of done deal and let's go on.
No, the speeches were of the most concern, both her what she said about sort of race-based theories of judging and what some people would call critical legal theory or critical race theory, the idea that judges you know, can't be impartial. So some of the, as I say, the racial and judicial philosophy type things she said in her speeches were, to me, pretty shocking. But if it had just been her speeches, I'm sorry, if it had just been her cases, then I don't think we would have opposed her. I certainly can point to a few cases that I'm very disturbed by, but I think that alone would not have been enough for us to oppose her, frankly.
She repudiated those things she had said. In fact, some people on the left were upset that she repudiated those statements as she did. You didn't believe her when she said, no, that's not what I meant?
Well, you know, people are referring to it as a confirmation conversion. Certainly, if one was ever going to retract things like that, it would be when you were nominated to the Supreme Court. I mean, you have a very high incentive to do it. Certainly, the White House wanted her to do it. So I don't know if it's genuine. It's really not, you know, not for me to say that it is or isn't genuine. Time will tell. I mean, I'd like to think that it is genuine. I'd like to think that she really has thought about it and realized that, well, some of the things she said might be, you know, good for speeches, might even be inspirational to certain groups, that they're inappropriate for a judge to say or to do. And if that's the case, then, you know, I'll be the first one to say, terrific. I'm glad she's changed her mind.
Keith, let me bring you into the conversation by asking you, in fact, what we're just hearing from Curt might suggest that the confirmation process is not all that it should be, and that these hearings allow for a lot of posturing on the part of members of the committee and a lot of perhaps evasion on the part of the nominee. Is there something wrong with the way this is set up, and should we not just be vetting a nominee, but vetting this process?
Well, in some ways, it's hard to imagine the process being much different. It's going to be a political process. Senators are designing the process and are going to use the process to appeal to their constituents and appeal to their supporters. And it's hard to imagine a process that's going to pull that politics out. So anytime you have a process involving senators, it's going to be a process that's designed to appeal to their voters and appeal to their supporters. And these are high-profile opportunities for senators to do that. And they're always going to engage in exactly these kinds of disputes. We only had these public hearings once senators in the early 20th century became elected by voters. And once we did that, then we decided to have public hearings on Supreme Court justices. And senators began to use them for exactly this kind of purpose.
I wonder, though, whether we really learn much about a nominee, if the nominee has to be so careful all the time to not say the wrong thing and to repudiate those things that have been said in the past. Keith, you think that the process works for getting to who the nominee really is?
I think there's very little that we're going to learn about nominees through this kind of process. I mean, the overall process, you do learn things. I mean, interest groups have a lot of incentives to bring new information to the table. And so the overall confirmation process, we learn a lot about nominees, not all of it very informative necessarily, but we learned about these speeches, we learned about the cases, there was a lot of public vetting that went on. But the hearing process itself may not be terribly informative. And there's going to be a lot of not very informative stuff that emerges during the confirmation process that you have to get through while also trying to figure out, well, what's real information here? What should we really focus on that's going to tell us very much about how this person's going to behave as a justice?
Solangel, you were part of a vetting process within the Hispanic bar. And what was it that you found out? And I assume that most of the people who were on that committee came in being very pro Sonia Sotomayor. What did you learn?
Well, I wouldn't say that everyone who was on the committee was pro Sotomayor. What the reason that the Hispanic National Bar Association asked law professors to analyze her cases is because they wanted academics. They did not want advocates. They wanted just academics, experts in their fields, to review her cases on ranging from, you know, criminal procedure to international law, immigration law, etc.
But you were her friend. Were you able to step out of the friend role and just...
Absolutely. I am her friend, but I have never appeared before her. I have never litigated before her. So I was reading her cases in the same way that I read any cases as I'm preparing for class. And what I found was that, I mean, her cases, as we have read repeatedly, are very narrow. She looks at the very narrow issue before her, and then very methodically goes through the facts and applies the law to the facts at hand. One of the things that I noted is that her cases would be the types of cases we'd love for law students to read, first year law students, because they are so carefully drafted. There's no bigger judicial philosophy. It's very clear that she is focusing on the legal issue and just applying the law to that. So her judicial philosophy, fidelity to the law. She applies the law.
Curt, you've been looking too. Is that the same conclusion you come to?
Well, you know, there certainly are cases where she does very careful analysis, but that's what made it so hard to understand and why some of her most controversial cases, the New Haven firefighters case, a property rights case in Connecticut, a couple of Second Amendment cases, there was no analysis. It was just a summary order, which is basically what you do when it's not even a controversial issue. What happened in the New Haven firefighters case was probably the most disturbing. There you had an issue that was so cutting edge that the Supreme Court took it. 9 justices on the Supreme Court disagreed with her. 5 thought that it should have gone the other way. 4 thought that instead of her granting summary judgments to the city, there should have been a trial. And yet she said the law was so clear the way she saw it that it didn't even need a published opinion or any legal analysis. And people have certainly speculated that that might be because she knows she's under consideration for the Supreme Court, and this was a controversial way to rule. Affirmative action is not that popular these days, and that she might have been trying to bury it. I can't get inside her head, but it is kind of, certainly some of her cases, she seems to have a great legal mind, and then in other cases, she seems to be ducking some of the most controversial issues. And I don't know why, but that was one thing we did find disturbing.
Keith, as you look forward to what this next term is going to be and all the years that we can expect that this new justice will be on the court, what do you expect of her, given what you've seen and what you've looked at?
Well, I think as you set up in the beginning, the expectation is she's going to join 3 other justices on the liberal wing of the court. She's largely going to vote in basically the same way that Justice Souter has.
The conservative majority remains.
The conservative majority is going to largely remain, although importantly, Justice Kennedy is the swing vote. And Justice Kennedy sometimes votes with the liberal wing, and in a lot of very important cases, Kennedy votes with the liberals. And as a consequence, you get some extremely important liberal decisions coming out of this court. So it's not that this court uniformly hands down conservative decisions. It hands down some extremely important liberal decisions. But generally speaking, I expect that she will vote in roughly the same way Souter does. The opinions won't be the same as Souter does, and there may be some slight deviations. But she's not radically going to change the composition of this court in the near future.
I wonder, Solangel, whether you felt comfortable with her having to back off so completely from the wise Latina comment?
I'm not sure that she was backing off because I do not interpret the wise Latina statement in the way that I think some conservatives interpret
it.
The way she phrased it may not have been the best way to phrase it, but I still believe that what she is saying is that life experiences do impact the way we're going to interpret certain facts. And she also added, if you read the entire speech, that simply because we are aware that life experiences may impact how we interpret certain information, what we have to do is sort of pull away from that, acknowledge that your experiences may impact your worldview, and then do your best to be completely impartial.
That was in the speech.
Yes.
But before the committee, she folded, it seems to me. Do you not agree?
She said that the way that her statement led people to believe something that she does not believe at all. It led people to believe that she was saying that being a Latina would reach a better decision than a white male. that is not what she never intended to make that statement. And I thought what she was trying was doing during the hearings was making it clear that she never meant to actually convey sort of that feeling.
A recent interview with Justice Ginsburg in the New York Times Magazine, she says, yes, women bring a different life experience to the table. All our differences make the conference better. That I'm a woman, that's part of it. That I'm Jewish, that's part of it. That I grew up in Brooklyn, New York, and I went to summer camp in the Adirondacks. All these things are part of me. Is that something you have a problem with?
Well, again, I think the way Solangel put it, which was that those things are naturally, you know, part of your life experiences, but you don't let it affect your decisions in a case. That's fine, but that doesn't seem to be what she was saying in all those speeches. She specifically said in those speeches that it's probably not possible or even desirable for a judge to be impartial. She seemed to be celebrating bringing your race and your life experiences into judging and coming on top of what President Obama had said, which is that judges should have empathy for certain specific groups, African Americans, the disabled, senior citizens, teenage mothers, which necessarily means having less empathy for their opponents in court.
Well, again, she
put
backed
together.
Off of the empathy position.
Yeah. No,
she actually
split
with President Obama.
She repudiated the president on that. I give her credit for that. And that's one reason why I said that in a lot of ways this whole process was a victory for conservatives, because the theory of judging that we've always espoused, which is basically the umpire theory, you just look at the law and the facts and you make your decision. Everyone now seems to agree that that is the way judging should be approached, and that's a change. For decades, people talked about a living constitution where you bring in your policy preferences and your progressive ideals, and that seems to be dead now. And so, I think that's a victory for those of us who believe, again, that judges shouldn't be making law, they should just be interpreting law.
Keith, that's one interpretation of what's going to be as a result of these hearings on Sotomayor. Do you buy that? Do you agree with that?
Well, I thought the empathy argument was a very undefined ideal for judging, and not one that fit in very well with any very well-specified theory about judging that was generally talked about in law schools or in general philosophies of judging generally. So it's hard to know sort of what to make of this argument about empathy beyond it being sort of a political claim and signaling the kind of person politically that Obama was going for. So it does seem like this is a failure for that kind of vision, and I think backing off of it is a victory for conservatives in that direction.
And in fact, do you think that Curt is correct that in fact going forward it will make it more difficult to have the sort of standard liberal empathy bearing nominee who's able to say that before a committee?
My suspicion is you'll go for a different kind of rhetoric. Instead, that there'll be a pitch next time for, if Obama wants to go for a self-consciously liberal appointee, that the argument will be positioned differently, and you'll see a different argument for why you ought to have a liberal justice, and it will be framed differently. They'll be connected to a different kind of judicial philosophy that won't be pitched in terms of empathy, but will be pitched in somewhat different kind of terms, and you'll have a potentially different fight over whether or not there ought to be a liberal judicial philosophy.
I can't believe the time is running down. We've got a minute and a half left. Let me ask you quickly, what's coming up in her first term that we ought to be watching, Solangel?
Well, obviously, the first case that we're all going to be watching is Citizens United, which is a re-argument from the last term. I'll defer to Curt.
I know you've been watching.
Since you've been watching.
Well, I'm going to be looking very closely at that one because Justice Sotomayor has been very outspoken about campaign finance reform, saying we need more of it and that contributions are basically no different than bribes. Now, I don't think she's going to recuse herself from this case because these were speeches. She hasn't been involved in this particular case, Citizens United, involving the famous Hillary movie. But I'm going to be looking closely and seeing if she can rise above. She clearly has policy preferences here. If she can rise above that and approach the law objectively like she promised to do. So I think this will be a great test.
Let me quickly, with 30 seconds left, ask all of you, Keith, starting with you, can you envision a time when we've got a majority non-white, majority female court that would more clearly perhaps reflect this population?
Oh, sure. I think we're moving in that direction now. You can see sort of the number of judges and qualified lawyers out there that certainly makes that a possibility in coming years.
Absolutely. As Justice Ginsburg pointed out, we have that in Canada.
Curt, you expect it?
Yeah, I think the courts are going to get more diverse, and that's great. I think people of all races and both genders can faithfully interpret the law like an umpire, and I look forward to that.
With my thanks to Curt Levey, to Keith Whittington, and to Solangel Maldonado, that's it for this edition of Due Process. But please join us again next week for more on the essentials of law and justice. Till then, for Raymond Brown, who had the day off, for Henrietta Parker, who is happily on the mend, and for all of us here at Due Process, I'm Sandra King. Thanks for watching.
The process of judging is enhanced when the arguments and concerns of the parties to the litigation are understood and acknowledged. That is why I generally structure my opinions by setting out what the law requires and then explaining why a contrary position, sympathetic or not, is accepted or rejected. That is how I seek to strengthen both the rule of law and faith in the impartiality of our judicial system. My personal and professional experiences help me to listen and understand, with the law always commanding the result in every case.
Major funding for Due Process provided by the New Jersey State Bar Foundation, committed to educating the public about the law, and by the Fund for New Jersey, supporting informed citizens for an effective democracy.